My name is Emma Schwartz. I'm the president of the Medical Center of the Americas Foundation. Welcome to the very first Tuesday Tech Talk here at the Cardwell Collaborative. Hopefully a place that you all can call your home for innovation and entrepreneurship and anything else we can do to help you be successful. I'm excited today to introduce Eric Pavia, our first speaker. Eric is the head of operations for
Notch. Yes.
It's an ad analytics company based in New York City. He's also an adjunct professor at UTEP's College of Business Administration, where he teaches a business law course focusing on ventures. Additionally, he serves as a consultant and advisor to companies who need assistance with business management issues. Clients have included a software development agency, a social network, and bakery upstart. Eric received his bachelor's in business administration from UTEP in 2010 with a focus on economics, then went to Stanford Law School, where he focused on issues relevant to early stage ventures, including venture capital, corporate law, IP, finance, and technology. While a student, he volunteered for the Stanford affiliate incubator, StartX, where he managed the educational program and alumni engagement. Eric graduated from Stanford Law in 2013 and joined his current company as the fourth employee. Interestingly, as part of sending out the invitation to this, I came to find out that Eric was in the very first year that the El Paso. He was in the very first year that the El Paso branch of the Federal Reserve Bank of Dallas started its Student Board of Directors program, a group that I actually speak to every year and always an incredibly impressive crowd. The Fed staff sent over this image of the cover of their 2007 annual report that has Eric's picture on the cover and information on him, and also down below a news article where Eric mentions how he fell in love with economics through this program at the Federal Reserve Bank of Dallas. Anyway, so it's kind of exciting to see him come full circle after that experience and what that experience locally can do for someone, and hopefully they come back and continue to help us out regionally. And we here at the MCA want to start our own student board of directors, and the Fed is going to help us do that. So hopefully we get some amazing success stories from that. With that, I will hand this back over to Eric for his discussion on the economics, character, and cultivation of El Paso's emerging startup ecosystem.
Thank you.
Oh, maybe before we get started, we can actually run around the room, and if you could just introduce yourself and say who you're with so that we can get a little bit of a context of who's interested in these kinds of topics.
Well, I'm Jose Carrillo, and I work at the Mexico Development Loan Fund.
Jesus Carrillo with the MCA.
I'm Brianna Mapes. I'm Eric's research.
My name is Ivo Legaspi. I'm in real estate development and multifamily.
I'm film production.
Michaela Linda Johnson. I'm here at El Paso. I'm an experienced business development manager for healthcare and biotech.
Alan Abbott. I'm involved in venture capital.
Don Shapiro, Coronado Studios. Thank you.
Rudy V at Dynatech Laboratories.
I'm Scott Olson with ECM International.
Charlie Schwab. I'm a retired U.S. Army officer, MBA student at UTEP right now, and a team leader in the Space Race Challenge trying to start up my own manufacturing company.
Ed Escudero, CEO of High Desert Capital, also the chair of the Medical Center of the Americas.
Robert Escudero, and I'm attending El Paso High School.
Hi everyone, I'm Laura Rodriguez with the Raven Group.
Hi, Laura Danish, Border Flex Alliance.
Natalie Littlefield with Workforce Solutions.
Jan Ingalls, a small business owner.
Laura Diaz from UTEP, undergraduate research.
Nicolás Silva, I'm applying to grad school and I have a degree in microbiology.
Jeff Uxberg, MCA.
Carlos Ortega, MCA.
Valentin Sandoval, Coronado Studios.
Amy Oliva, City of El Paso Economic Development.
Ana Elisa Holguin, International Business Development Manager for the City of El Paso.
Oh, and Priscilla
Lago
with
MCA. All right. So, I guess to get started, I didn't necessarily know who my audience was going to be, so I kind of prepped this to be very broad. I know it's called Tech Talk. I'm not going to talk about any technology in this. Given that it is the first Tech Talk, though, I thought it would be a good idea to talk about, more abstractly, how it is a tech ecosystem together. So the first section I'm going to run through just a comparison to Silicon Valley, and then I'll talk a little bit about why El Paso shouldn't necessarily try to be that. Because I think a lot of, for a little bit of context, Emma mentioned that I used to volunteer with it was a nonprofit called StartX, and it's a tech incubator out of Stanford, and it incubates a bunch of like technology companies that come out of Stanford University, many of them very successful, one of them, which I work for now. And while I was there, every week or so, we had a delegate come in from some sort of country. So we either had some Japanese prime minister, chief of staff, or head of technological development, or heads of state from, or not necessarily heads of state, but administrators from, we had people come in from Germany, we had people come in from Brazil. We had people, delegates from all these different countries coming in to figure out what is it that made Silicon Valley special and how it is that they could go back and reproduce all of that. So I thought it'd be cool and fun to just kind of talk about why the Silicon Valley ecosystem exists. We talked about a little bit about how I studied econ at UTEP, and what actually inspired me to study economics was this book called Freakonomics. I don't know if any of you guys have read Freakonomics. So Freakonomics has these interesting questions, these fun questions that they like to pose at the beginning of each chapter, these weird zany questions. So I kind of came up with one of my own. So the Freakonomics type question is, how is Silicon Valley like a five-star hotel? How is it like a five-star hotel? So when we talk about Silicon Valley, I don't know if any of you have seen the hit TV show Silicon Valley on HBO. It's amazing. That's exactly what Silicon Valley is like. You should watch it. But this is the title screen. You have all these Silicon Valley type companies. You have Twitter, YouTube, Google's there. This is one thing that I didn't totally understand. It's actually a geographic area, right? So Silicon Valley I thought when I was growing up, I it was some abstraction for some area on the West Coast where some technology companies existed, somewhere between Seattle and LA. But it's really just a very narrow strip of land, right? So it starts kind of in San Francisco. Uber is moving their offices up to Oakland, so maybe we'll include that as part of Silicon Valley sometime next year. But it's really just this peninsula, right? And you'll find all of the different tech companies here in this area, all of the big Fortune or 500 type companies. We got Facebook, Oracle, Genentech, Google, Apple's here in Cupertino. I live somewhere over here. All of these different companies are here. We also have Stanford. Berkeley is up here, right north of Oakland. And we have San Jose State University. So what you get arising out of Silicon Valley is this term that we call economies of agglomeration, right? So why does Silicon Valley exist the way that it exists? And it's because of this concept or this phenomenon that occurs in different markets and different industries called economies of agglomeration. And naturally, you'll find that firms in related industries tend to cluster together. So if you go to New York, you'll find a diamond district, right? Where you can go off and buy diamonds. Or also in New York, are all the day traders and investment bankers. I guess you can find a diamond district in any major city. Or you'll find, the areas in the city like Union Square in San Francisco where all of the high-end retail is at, right? Or you'll find bars. Bars is a common one. So, looking at El Paso, Cincinnati Street used to be kind of where all the bars are. I don't know where it is now because I moved out a while ago, but I heard they moved somewhere off by Sonoma, right? At a smaller level, you'll find things like flea markets, right? So you'll have these different firms that are in the same industry clustered together. And the reason this happens is because when a firm establishes itself in a location, it creates what we call positive externalities or externalities, right? So if I'm a bar and I open up in real close to a campus, right, near a college campus, because who likes to drink? College students, even though many of them aren't supposed to. Then, and all the college students come to, I mean, I guess you see this in like 6th Street in Austin, right? All the college students get out of class and they go to your one bar after class. A competitor is going to see that, hey, there's a high demand for bars in the area, and they can just open up a shop right next door, right? So now on this one strip, maybe it's Cincinnati, maybe it's 6th Street in Austin, you don't only have one bar, now you have two bars. And now it's known as the place where if you want to go get a drink, you just go to this street, right? So maybe a third bar will open up because now everybody associates this one street with bars, and that's where you go for a drink, and a third bar can open up. And before you know it, this sort of snowballs, and you have 6th Street in Austin, which is a really long strip of, I mean, it's maybe like 6 or 7 blocks of nothing but bars, right? Or you get a flea market. Somebody sets up a little tent somewhere and sells their wares, and people know that you can buy the best wares at this little flea market, or at this one little tent. So next Sunday, next Saturday, someone else is gonna pop up their own little tent and start selling their own wares. And you see this happen across all sorts of industries, different parts of the world at all levels. So why does this happen in Silicon Valley? So very abstractly, I think you need 4 things to start a company, right? If you want to start a new venture, a new tech company. The first is capital, right? Everybody knows you need some sort of VC money. You have to pay the staff, you have to pay for your office. You need ideas, right? So you need some sort of novel thing that you're going to put out into the market that nobody else has done before. You need labor, you need somebody to build this stuff. You need somebody to work for you, you need to sell the product, you need to build the product, whatever it might be. You know, you'll find all of the different tech companies here in this area, all of the big Fortune or 500 tech companies. We got Facebook, Oracle, Genentech, Google, Apple's here in Cupertino. I live somewhere over here. All of these different companies are here. We also have Stanford. Berkeley is up here, right north of Oakland. And we have San Jose State University. So what you get arising out of Silicon Valley is this term that we call economies of agglomeration. Right? So why does Silicon Valley exist the way that it exists? And it's because of this concept or this phenomenon that occurs in different markets and different industries called economies of agglomeration. And naturally, you'll find that firms in related industries tend to cluster together. So if you go to New York, you'll find like a diamond district, right? Where you can go off and buy diamonds. Or also in New York, you know, where all the day traders and investment bankers. I guess you can find a diamond district in like any major city. Or you'll find, you know, like the areas in the city, like Union Square in San Francisco, where like all of the high-end retail is at, right? Or you'll find bars. Bars is a common one. So, I mean, looking at El Paso, Cincinnati Street used to be kind of where all the bars are. I don't know where it is now because I moved out a while ago, but I heard they moved somewhere like off by Sano, right? So even like at a smaller level, you'll find things like flea markets, right? So you'll have these different firms that are in the same industry clustered together. And the reason this happens is because when a firm establishes itself in a location, it creates what we call positive externalities or externalities, right? So if I'm a bar and I open up in real close to a campus, right, near a college campus, because who likes to drink? College students, even though many of them aren't supposed to. Then, and all the college students come to, I mean, I guess you see this on like 6th Street in Austin, right? All the college students get out of class and they go to your one bar after class. A competitor is going to see that, hey, there's a high demand for bars in the area, and they can just open up a shop right next door, right? So now on this one strip, maybe it's Cincinnati, maybe it's 6th Street in Austin, you don't only have one bar, now you have two bars. And now it's known as the place where if you want to go get a drink, you just go to this street, right? So maybe a third bar will open up because now everybody associates this one street with bars, and that's where you go for a drink. And a third bar can open up. And before you know it, this sort of snowballs, and you have 6th Street in Austin, which is a really long strip of, I mean, it's maybe like 6 or 7 blocks of nothing but bars, right? Or you get a flea market. Somebody sets up a little tent somewhere and sells their wares, and people know that you can buy the best wares at this little flea market, or this one little tent. So next Sunday, next Saturday, someone else is gonna pop up their own little tent and start selling their own wares. And you see this happen across all sorts of industries, different parts of the world at all levels. So why does this happen in Silicon Valley? So very abstractly, I think you need four things to start a company, right? If you want to start a new venture, a new tech company. The first is capital, right? Everybody knows you need some sort of VC money. You have to pay the staff, you have to pay for your office. You need ideas, right? So you need some sort of novel thing that you're going to put out into the market that nobody else has done before. You need labor, you need somebody to build this stuff. You need somebody to work for you, you need to sell the product, you need to build the product, wherever it might be. And finally, you need suppliers for the things that you can't build in-house. So the first, capital. So if you look at Silicon Valley, here is Stanford University, and really close to Stanford University is a street called Sand Hill Road. It is actually right next to Silicon Valley. So we can kind of zoom into it on Google Maps. It's actually a street called Sand Hill Road. And here, I mean, Google Maps kind of like pre-populated some of these. You'll find some of the top venture capital funds. So you'll find Sequoia Capital is here, Greylock Partners is here, Lightspeed Venture Partners is here, another big firm called August Capital is here. Every big Silicon Valley VC fund is going to be along the street. So again, we kind of see this example of economies of agglomeration happening, right? A VC at some point in the history of Silicon Valley opened up their office, and if you're a young Stanford student who's got this great new technology that you want to get developed, you can easily just like cross the street and go talk to this guy about how you can get your new venture financed. And you know, maybe two or three other offices open up nearby. And now what happens is, you know, some entrepreneur, maybe they're coming from Stanford or some other area of Silicon Valley, maybe they're flying in from New York. There's actually blog posts about this. They do the Sand Hill Road walk. So they'll go from one, they'll just schedule meetings all day. You know, maybe they'll schedule a meeting with Greylock at like 1 p.m. And then they'll email another partner at Lightspeed and say, hey, I'm gonna be at Greylock 1 p.m. on Monday. Is it cool if I just like walk over to your office after that? And maybe on their way walking over to Lightspeed Venture, somebody here at August Capital watches them walking across the street, and they'll say like, hey, you know, entrepreneur, I saw you walking to Lightspeed the other day. What are you doing? Are you raising money? Do you wanna come on over to our place to talk about what it is you're building? So, you know, at this very high level, you can see the economies of agglomeration taking effect with this like one piece of Silicon Valley, which is like raising capital. More abstractly, it's not just that one road. This is the amount of venture capital investment by region in the country. So you can see all of it sort of accrues in Silicon Valley. It's more than two-thirds. The amount of venture capital invested in Silicon Valley is more than the amount of venture capital invested in the rest of the country combined. I think it's about 66% or something. What's also interesting, I mean, I showed you guys a map of Silicon Valley. It's a little, you know, maybe 20-mile strip of land. The next largest region, the way they categorized it, is New England. That's several states. So it's a little strip of land in California versus several states. Then you get to the New York metro area, which is New York City, New Jersey. The southeast, so this includes like all of Florida, Georgia, Atlanta. And then finally you get to the entire state of Texas. So again, you see this phenomenon continuing to show itself where similar industries will cluster together. So why is it that happens? Why is all of the VC money in Silicon Valley? Is it because it's like some sort of special place that like, you know, only money, you know, maybe there's just like bigger vaults there for all the cash. They can't keep their cash anywhere else. Well, in Silicon Valley, you'll find ideas and labor, right? You'll find what it is you need to make a successful company and to make a successful investment. And again, we see these economies of agglomeration showing the traits of economies of agglomeration showing themselves. So going back to this map, I actually don't know who made this map, but it's really helpful. HP's founding garage is here in Palo Alto, like right across the street from Stanford University. But more importantly, I guess to kind of take a step back, if you want to invest in good ideas and you want to invest in good people, if you're a venture capitalist, you know, what do you have here that's going to produce good ideas and good people? The first thing you're going to find is you're going to have a bunch of universities up and down the strip. So you have Stanford University on this map. San Francisco State University has got a great medical school up in San Francisco. Berkeley's a little bit further up north. Even just a little bit, maybe an hour up is UC Davis. Like right south of San Francisco, you have San Jose State University. A bunch of the different California schools. You have Cal Poly a few miles down. So, you know, in this little region, you have a ton of different universities, and all of them are producing great research, great alumni, people with great ideas. But you also have a bunch of different companies, right? So you have Facebook is here, Google is here, Yahoo is here. If you're an engineer working at Facebook or you're working at Google, a lot of my, I won't say their names, but like, you know, I have a lot of friends who work at Google and they get bored. Google's this gigantic company, right? And they get these little tiny assignments to work on this gigantic company. And they have a few hours every day to just kind of like think about something else. So they'll get bored of working at Google or they'll get bored of working at Facebook and, you know, maybe they'll look around and they'll say, hey, I can do this myself. So they'll quit their jobs and they'll start a company, right? And who do you think that they hire when they start their first company? Well, they hire the people that are working with them at Facebook, right? Or they'll hire the people that are working with them at Google. If you look at Snapchat, Snapchat came out of Stanford. Snapchat's really employees, they're all Stanford students, right? So Evan Spiegel you know, dropped out of Stanford to go work on Snapchat full time, and he hired up a bunch of his friends, designers, engineers, whatever it might be. So you have all of these different tech startups, and again, they produce this positive externality. They have a bunch of extra ideas, extra labor, and they kind of, you know, leak out of these bigger institutions and out into these little bitty startups. To kind of give an idea of how this works, and this isn't just to talk up Stanford just because I'm an alumni of the school, I think it's just a great example of how this happens. So these are all Stanford, various Stanford alumni companies, not necessarily in any order. So these, all of these companies were started by people who either graduated from or dropped out of Stanford. So you can see this happening, right? I'll go to another example. So let me just kind of run through some of these. If you guys can see them, HP is one of the older ones, and if you walk around the Bay Area, everything's named after either, or if you walk around Stanford's campus, everything's named after either Hewlett or Packard. PayPal is a big one. We'll get into that a little bit. Google's also a big one. And I just talked about Snapchat. There's one. So what do all of these companies have in common? I don't know if any of you guys can guess. These are all multi-billion dollar companies. I think all of them are, no, not all of them are public. I guess Yammer was acquired by Microsoft, and Yelp was, YouTube was acquired by Google. Does anyone know what all of these companies have in common? They weren't all started by Stanford grads. They have something else in common. So all of these companies were started by people who once worked at PayPal. So like I said, you know, these guys are all working at PayPal, and you know, maybe they have a bunch of really good ideas, right? And you know, or they learn what it takes to start a successful company at PayPal. So when PayPal goes public and then gets bought out by eBay, you know, all of these guys go off with the several millions of dollars that they made off of the sale, and they all go off and start different companies, right? So Tesla was started by Elon Musk. Elon Musk was one of the co-founders of the entity that eventually became PayPal. LinkedIn was started by Reid Hoffman. Reid Hoffman was a VP at PayPal. Palantir was started by Peter Thiel and Joe Lonsdale. Peter Thiel was the co-founder of PayPal. I mean, SpaceX is kind of a cheat because it's also started by Elon Musk. But all of these, the founders of all of these companies were early employees at PayPal. So why does this happen? Why is it that we get you know, schools generating tons of incredibly valuable companies, or even one company generating a lot of incredibly valuable companies from, you know, just the early founding team? And what you'll see is that
people who kind of exist in the Valley who are in the startup space will follow this weird reincarnation cycle. It's almost like that thing they show you in second grade with like water and precipitation in the clouds, right? So someone will start a company, right? Maybe it's their first time. They're like a first-time founder. They don't really know what they're doing. Oops. Well, I guess I'm supposed to do stuff. So they'll start a company, and maybe it's successful, right? And they IPO and make a bunch of money. And they can take that money and that knowledge and they can do one of two things, right? They can go be an investor, so they can take the capital that they got from their exit, and then they can just reinvest it into someone else's company. Whose company do you think they'll reinvest in after their sale?
Friends.
Their friends, right? And their friends were all the people that used to work with. Oh, my bad.
Okay.
So they'll work with all of their, you know, they'll reinvest in their friends, right? The guys that, you know, if you're Peter Thiel is a very well-known Silicon Valley investor. He was one of the first investors in LinkedIn, right? That was a company that was started by his friend Reid Hoffman. So you'll take this capital that you've accumulated because of your successful founding of a company, and you'll just reinvest in your friends. Or you might go to a company that started and be an advisor to them, right? And give share that knowledge that you've acquired from starting your own company. Or you might even just get hired onto the executive team of that company. And maybe you get bored after a little while, and you know you've been an executive at this company for long enough, and you get some good ideas. You quit and you go start another company. So to kind of give like a weird real life example of this, I don't know if you guys have heard of Zenefits, but Zenefits is a startup that is doing HR management, like HR and benefits management. And they got in a lot of trouble because they weren't complying with the regulations that you need to comply with to be an insurance broker. So the CEO was fired, and he was replaced by a guy named David Sachs, who also worked at PayPal. So David Sachs is now the CEO of Zenefits, the founder of Zenefits. I'm forgetting his name currently. What do you think he went to go do after he started this multi-billion dollar company and then got fired? He started another company, right? So he just went right back over here. So what you see is these people who have all of these ideas, you know, will start a company, fail, succeed. Even if they fail, right, they've learned a bunch of lessons around how it is that you start a company. Maybe they've met a lot of really interesting people. They've met investors if they've raised money. And you know, no investor expects all of their investments to succeed in Silicon Valley, so they might still maintain that relationship. They've had employees. They can go off and just kind of share that knowledge in different ways and then come right back in and start another company, right? So that's why Stanford has so many big companies coming out of it, is because some of them are just started by the same people. Or if you go to a school with a bunch of different Stanford people and one of them starts a company, maybe you become their first employee and can kind of like join in the cycle. So the last thing I think you need is sort of suppliers and service providers. Silicon Valley has a bunch of very specialized service providers. There's a bank called Silicon Valley Bank that's like specifically caters to startups. So they offer like specialized loans that like no other bank in the world would offer. Zenefits, which I just mentioned, which does like HR management, because if you're like the fourth employee at a company like I was, you don't have payroll to hire like an HR person, so you kind of need software for this. You have a bunch of platforms for hiring engineers because that's incredibly competitive. You have law firms that specialize specifically in the issues that tech startups deal with. So one of my best friends, who also graduated from UTEP, is currently my roommate in Silicon Valley. And he works at Fenwick & West, and his job is seriously just to do investments. That's all he does. It's a full-time job for him for tech startups. So he just sees the same clients over and over. These guys have become incredibly specialized. And other kind of like consumer products, right? So to go back to this question, how is Silicon Valley like a five-star hotel? We looked at Sand Hill Road, right? And at the end of Sand Hill Road, so here on Sand Hill Road, you have all these VCs, and they're all making tons of money and investing in all these innovative companies. And at the end of Sand Hill Road, there's this very nice hotel called the Rosewood Sand Hill Hotel. And inside of the Rosewood Hotel, there is a very nice restaurant called the Madeira. I think it's Michelin rated. I got to have steak there once, it's so expensive.
But the Madeira has, you know, it's a hotel, so they've got like a hotel restaurant and a hotel bar. Naturally, is this hotel. So to answer the question of how Silicon Valley is like a five-star hotel, this five-star hotel also exhibits economies of agglomeration. So every Thursday night, there's a special event that happens at the Rosewood Hotel Bar. If you're a young BC, you know, and you've had a very long day of work, what do you think you're going to go do after work? CrossFit. You might go out and you might have, at the end of the day, what are you going to do? You might go out and have a drink, right? And maybe you want to meet a special lady when you're out having a drink, right? And all of the young BCs, they come down to the Rosewood Hotel after their long day of work, because it's just at the end of the street. If you're, you know, a recently divorced, older, nice woman, and you want to meet a successful young man, where do you think you're going to go find successful young men? You're going to go to the Rosewood Hotel on the Thursday, because Thursday night at the Rosewood Hotel is Cougar Night. This is actually an event. As you can see, it's very well populated, where you know, nice older ladies will go meet nice, successful younger men. And it's the exact same phenomenon that we see occurring with Silicon Valley, right? If I'm an engineer and I want to get a job working as a software engineer, where am I going to go? I'm going to go where I know all the jobs are, right? I'm going to go to this area where Facebook is right up the street from Google. And they're not right up the street, but they're close enough. They're both kind of like right off Mountain Dew. If I'm a venture capitalist and I want to invest in really good ideas, I'm going to go where all these people are quitting their Facebook and Google jobs, and I'm going to make investments in these guys because I think that, you know, that's where I'm going to find success. And if I'm a supplier of some sort, if, you know, I have a very specialized practice, I'm going to go to where I can find clients or people to buy my specialized service. So, you know, it kind of begs the question, what can we reproduce? What's reproducible from that? I think when you abstract this concept of Silicon Valley being just a big economy of agglomeration, right, you can kind of distill out a few interesting insights. So we talked about, you know, what it is you need to start a company. And people might, I mean, this is a framework that I came up with. But, you know, we talk about capital, ideas, labor, and suppliers, right? You can kind of break these out into two different categories. So the first are ideas and labor, and the second are capital and suppliers. And the difference between those two is that these just come from people, right? People are come up with all of your ideas, they provide all the work. People are really what makes an economy an economy. Capital and suppliers, you can kind of get those anywhere. Capital can cross borders, it's very liquid. Our company is now in New York, but our bank is still in California. All of our lawyers are still in California, right? We just communicate through email. So the big difference is the second requirement, capital and suppliers, are liquid, but your people are not, right? People, they can move, definitely. I mean, you can, you know, pack up and move your bags and go to another city. But you know, if you're going to work somewhere, if you're young and engineering, you need a job. You're going to fly out to Silicon Valley and you're going to start knocking on doors in Silicon Valley to get jobs there. So companies are made by people. They're not made by capital. They're not made by specialized suppliers. You know, just because Silicon Valley has, you know, this crazy graph where, you know, all VC money is invested in Silicon Valley, that's not what makes Silicon Valley special. It's people that make Silicon Valley special. What can you do to make sure that all the, you know, young engineers who just graduated want to come work in your city and not somewhere else? So to figure that out, you have to ask the question, what do they care about, right? You're selling to them. They're sort of your customer. What do they care about? How do you get people to stick around? And if you're hiring, you know, young engineers and, you know, young tech talent, young entrepreneurs such as myself, you care about all these things, right? They're going to care about craft beer, and they're going to care about mixed-use development and farms. That's, I'm kidding, totally. That is not. I think that's the stereotype of what people think that young people care about. You know, these young engineers, this young talent, they care about what everyone else cares about, right? You want career opportunities. You want access to great education for yourself and for your children. You want a good quality of life. You want fun things to do, definitely, so you definitely want some of the craft beer, farm-to-table dining things, and that changes generation to generation, but that's pretty low on the list compared to the other things, right? So there's all these articles about, like, how do you appeal to millennials? You just appeal to them the way that you appeal to the other human. And finally, affordability, right? Emma and I were just talking about this. I'm actually ditching my apartment in California because I'm on the road so much, and I pay about $3,000 per month to live in the state. So I'm just going to ditch it and be a nomad, because affordability matters. So how do you attract people? Well, you give them what it is they care about, right? And I think what the MCA is doing here is very incredible and very impressive, especially for a person like myself who's left the city on the career opportunities front and what it is that the organization is trying to do to spur that type of development. But El Paso's got a lot going for it, kind of across the board. I mean, I think this is kind of developing and burgeoning, and there's a lot of job opportunities, especially on the medical front, as Emma has educated me today. But it's a fun place to be. It's not an expensive place to be. And it's consistently ranked as one of the best places to live with quality of life, right? So I think when you talk about how is it that you can become like the Silicon Valley, not that any of you asked, but that's a common question, you want to play up to your strengths. So the next little portion I want to talk about is, what I believe the strengths of people coming out of El Paso are. So I just came up with this. People talk about like the School of Hard Knocks. I feel like this has some better like phonetics to it. University of adversity. It sounds like something from a cheesy rhyme. I'll sell it to him. So I kind of got that from this John D. Rockefeller. So John D. Rockefeller once said that young men, I guess it applies to young women as well, are incredibly lucky to struggle for a foundation early in life. Right? There are a lot of things that you can learn if growing up wasn't very easy for you. And the reason this is valuable and the reason why I think El Paso is special is as far as it relates to creating good people and wanting to keep those good people around is that being an entrepreneur is incredibly hard. You're an entrepreneur and you're kind of starting on this journey yourself. And it's both mentally and emotionally hard, but it's also, just from like a statistics standpoint, it's incredibly hard. So entrepreneurs earn 35% less over a 10-year period than they could have earned on a paid job. If you decide to become an entrepreneur, you're losing money. 75% of VC-backed companies don't generate a return for the founders. So you could work for a startup for 5, 6, 7 years, or maybe 3, 4 years, and all you get out of it is whatever salary you paid yourself over the life of the company. A lot of times, founders will sell their company for millions, and none of that goes to themselves. And this all these statistics, by the way, come from a book called, if any of you are interested, it's called The Founder's Dilemmas. It's by Noam Wasserman. And he's a Harvard Business School researcher who focuses on entrepreneurship. And he did this like very large quantitative analysis on startups and the challenges they face and the difficult decisions they have to make. Kind of from a less statistical point, I'm sure you've heard this line, entrepreneurs are people who work 80 hours to avoid working 40, right? It's a hard job, being an entrepreneur. But I think being from El Paso, you have this upbringing that, John D. Rockefeller had, where you face adversity early in life and that teaches you to be tough. So this is from the book Dune. If you're not familiar with it, it's a very nerdy science fiction book where this royal family has to go from this planet that's like full of beaches and water and trees, and they have to like flee to the desert. And one of the lines early on in the book is that polish comes from the city and wisdom comes from the desert. So growing up here, I feel like there are a few traits or characteristics of El Pasoans that make us really good, or should make for really good entrepreneurs. And I'll kind of run through each of these in a minute. And I guess for a little background on myself as to like why I feel qualified to speak on this, I grew up in El Paso, in Camotillo, it was like a little double wide trailer, and there was just like dirt. Like I would walk out of my house and it was just dirt. And my dad's a construction worker, my mom clean houses and stuff, so I definitely had the like very stereotypical El Paso upbringing. We'll go through each of these. So I think one thing, if you're from El Paso, you tend to be first generation something, right? And I keep saying El Paso, I should say the region, actually. I grew up in El Paso, I'm from El Paso, but I think this actually applies to the region as a whole. So like New Mexico, the border area, and Mexico and Juarez as well. So you tend to be first generation something if you're from the region, right? Maybe you're first generation American. Maybe you're first generation like high school graduate. Maybe you're first generation college graduate. Maybe you're a first generation grad school student. Maybe you're a first generation business person. Maybe you're a first generation entrepreneur. Almost every person that I've met in the region grew up being the first in their family to do something. And the reason that that's valuable is that every successful startup is necessarily doing something, right? If you're going to succeed as a tech company, you are by necessity doing something that no one else has done before. Even if you're Facebook and you were like the 100th social network, you did something different from every other social network that no other social network was doing that made you Facebook, right? If you're gonna be successful, you're gonna do something new. And in this area, new is the way of life. As you grow up, as you move through your adult career, your professional career, that's just what it is. It's not scary. It's kind of good to give a comparison to this. When I was a student at Stanford, I had a bunch of like classmates who were third generation Stanford law students, and they were afraid of their lives to disappoint their like father and grandfather who had also gone to Stanford Law School. And I was very blessed. I was able to go out and take risks and kind of like mess around and ditch class every now and then to go like tech talks. Because my dad, didn't go to college, didn't go to law school, was just happy that I was there in the first place, right? So having that freedom gave me the opportunity to really experiment and really try something new. And when everything is new, it's also valuable for entrepreneurs because you have no expectations. And having no expectations is really important because, like I just said, being an entrepreneur is incredibly hard. And if you know how hard it's going to be, you probably wouldn't do it. There's a lot of research that goes into entrepreneurs and whether or not they're crazy, because it's irrational to be an entrepreneur. I just gave all these statistics. One characteristic that people commonly find about entrepreneurs is that they're irrationally optimistic. And most of the time, they're irrationally optimistic because they just don't really know what lies ahead of them. It reminds me a little bit of Luke in Star Wars, who's also from the desert, going up against Darth Vader and the Empire because he has no idea how big it is and how suicidal his run against the Death Star is going to be. But because he doesn't have any expectation of failure or success, he's able to do it. And if you're an entrepreneur, the odds are stacked against you, right? You have competitors, you have a bunch of different amounts of risk, which I'll get into shortly. So it's incredibly difficult. And even if you're not a first generation in something in this region, which I doubt, I'm sure everyone in this room is the first in their family or in their neighborhood to do something, the odds are kind of stacked against you anyway, right? Even nature is against you. Our sun burns us, our rain floods us, the wind stings us, the plants stab us, and our animals poison us. So going out your door, even just day-to-day activity, is very difficult growing up in the region, right? Everything's stacked against you. So this is great for tourism, is that what you're saying? But it's true. When I first moved to California, that was like my first time leaving the area and spending any significant amount of time in El Paso. And not to quote Star Wars again, I'm just outing myself as a huge geek. It's like if you saw the new Star Wars movie, the girl's like, I didn't know there was this much green in the entire galaxy. Like that's what it's like. You just don't realize. Like, whoa, trees can get that big. It's kind of mind blowing. Because you're just used to these like tough conditions. So even if you're not first generation anything, just going to the store, making it to a tech talk, like that's a challenge. The odds here are always stacked against you. So it reminds me of this great quote by Mark Twain, where he says, they did not know it was impossible, so they did it, right? And I think not having that baggage and not having those expectations allows for you to be irrationally optimistic, and that's particularly good for founders. On the flip side, it's not necessarily the best trait to have because it can cut against you as well, right? If you don't know what's possible, what's impossible, oftentimes you also don't know what is possible. And Emma and I spoke about this for a while, but growing up here, I didn't realize this, but now I realize that I didn't have any models for what it was like to be a successful entrepreneur. I knew one professional growing up, and he was a lawyer, was my best friend's father. And so I thought that the way that you became successful in life was to become an attorney. So I spent most of my early years preparing to go to law school, right? So not knowing what's possible can also be a knock against you because you might not actually go out and even make the attempt in the first place. It took me a while to realize that companies are really just made by people who are flesh and blood. And I didn't learn that lesson until I was much older in life. When I was touring the Bay Area, like when I went to tour Stanford for Advent Weekend, this nice man was nice enough to kind of drive me around. He was pointing out different landmarks. And at the time, Facebook and HP were right across the street from each other. He's like, that's Facebook and that's HP. And I had an HP computer that I used to go like mess around on Facebook with, right? So it was incredible for me to see that these incredibly valuable companies were coming out of a regular old office. And I didn't have that growing up here in El Paso. So I think not having that context can be good for you and it can also be bad for you. The second trait I've noticed that's very common to the area and kind of relates to being first generational is that people here tend to be self-starters. You might be able to peg it to the culture of immigration in the area. So this is actually from another PayPal person. This is from an article that was written recently about this new visa that the White House has been working on for entrepreneurs. And he says, immigrants are long in ambition and short on things to lose. And another way to frame that is that you have a small downside and a big upside. And if you're an investor, this is all you're looking for always, right? I mean, maybe not, maybe the investors can tell me, but generally you're looking for something that's got a small downside and a big upside, right? And if it has this risk profile, you're a lot more likely to take it on. So if you're a person who's first generation or something and you don't have much to lose because you don't have three generations of law school graduates in your family, or maybe you're the only person in your family in the United States, it's a lot easier for you to take these risks. And that engenders a lot of both positive and negative traits, right? So you're more likely to kind of just go out and do things on your own, strike it out on your own, because nobody's going to teach you how, right? So you work really hard, you take no handouts, you take no help, and that's important, right? Because if you're starting a company, the person who's doing all of the work is you. You're both incorporating your company and striking your first deal, and you're taking out the trash. Kind of to go back to this Noam Wasserman person, he describes founders as, he says, founders, and by founders he means like entrepreneurs and people who start companies. Founders are individuals who start new organizations to pursue opportunities without regard to the resources they currently control, right? So you go out, again, irrationally optimistic about what it is you can achieve. You don't realize that you're severely undercapitalized, underfunded, understaffed, and you kind of just go out and try to do it, and you pull these resources in. When I read this quote, honestly, kind of just reminds me of people from here, right? You just go out and strike it out on your own, and it doesn't matter that you don't have a trust fund to fall on. It doesn't matter that you're the first person in your family to graduate from college. You're going to go out and try to do it, and you're going to pull different things in. Again, everything kind of comes with its downside, and I think the problem with this is that a lot of people end up reinventing the wheel, right? You don't want to take handouts, you don't want to take help. So one characteristic that I see in my friends and that I personally had to overcome was just going out and asking for help, and going to people who know what it is they're doing, who've experienced what it is that you're doing, and who can accelerate your growth, right? So we looked at the reincarnation of an entrepreneur. That's a very important practice in Silicon Valley. If you're going to start a company in healthcare, you're not going to just try to figure out how to start a healthcare company. You're going to try to find an introduction to somebody who's already done it. And they're going to tell you all the problems that they faced and all the problems that you're going to face. And that way you're aware of them, right? And you can get around them. Or you get a series of really good investors who have industry expertise and they're going to accelerate your growth. And I know, I mean, again, kind of just speaking to my own person, I hated going out for help when I was a student. Like, I felt like if I went out and asked for help, I wasn't doing it by myself, and I was getting, like, a handout, and I hated it. And I think it's important to understand where the difference is between help and handouts, and not be too proud to seek help where it is you need it. And the reason isn't necessarily because, you know, you don't want to be noble and don't want to be hardworking, but if you're doing a startup, you're doing something new, you're doing something incredibly risky, and you want to minimize the amount of risk you're taking, right? So you go out to talk to these people who've already done this stuff, because you don't want to take any more risk than you have to. So Mark Andreessen runs the, he's one of the partners at Andreessen Horowitz. It's a fund with $2.7 billion under management, and they're very well known for the types of investments they make. To kind of go back to our life cycle of an entrepreneur, Mark Andreessen was the founder of Netscape, which was one of the original internet browsers, right? So he started Netscape, that was very successful, and then he became a VC. And he talks about these different types of risks that you take on when you're an entrepreneur. He talks about these different risks that you take on when you're an entrepreneur. So, you know, and if you are one of those entrepreneurs, you want to minimize the type of risk you take. So it's not necessarily that you're not taking risk, it's that instead of not taking any risk, you want to take selective risk instead. I need to start. Yeah. It's not about taking risk, it's about taking selective risk, right? So you have these different layers of risk. You don't want to take on all of them if you don't have to. You want to whittle it down to just the key things. So if it's a new technology that you're creating that nobody has ever created before, that's what you want to risk the company on. Right, that's what you have to risk the company. You don't want to risk the company on some other problem that somebody has already figured out, right? If somebody has already figured it out, you can just take that solution and keep moving forward on the thing that's actually hard. Finally, the last kind of trait that I feel El Paso engenders in people or the region engenders in people that's good for entrepreneurship is humility. And I don't necessarily mean humility as sort of being humble from personality perspective, but it's more of humility in the sense of ego. And I got this quote from a book that I'm currently reading. It says, grand creative visions translate to small daily movements, right? So every day you just have to do a little bit, and eventually you'll be able to achieve your grand creative vision. And it takes humility to do that, right? As I mentioned before, when you're an entrepreneur, you might be doing something incredibly important, like developing this new technology that is going to, you know, revolutionize the way that something in the market operates. But you might also be taking out the trash. You might also be manually writing checks for payroll. There's a lot of non-glamorous work that goes into it. It's not a sexy job. I got to work with a lot of entrepreneurs when I was at StartX, and you know, these dudes are just sitting in shorts at their computer until like 3 a.m. every day eating ramen. Like, it's a stereotype, but it's true. There's this quote, you know, don't lose the forest for the trees. But somebody needs to plant the trees in the first place, right? Somebody has to go out and do all of that work. So it's incredibly important to stay humble to be able to do all of that. And I think it's a characteristic and a trait that I think is very common from here. Again, going back to the first generationalism, you know, like my dad's a construction worker, and my very first job was to go out and like help him. Like, I mean, so he does pipe welding for different types of welding. But I would like clean up the pipes with like a grinder and kind of like take out the scrap metal and like sweep the work area and stuff. And he taught me from a very young age, you know, that all work is work, right? And you want to be good at whatever job it is that you do. And I think that's something that is common. I was picking one of my good friends is from El Paso. He went to school with me at Stanford, and I kind of ran this presentation through him, or by him first. And he's like, you know, dude, like, my dad wakes up at 6 a.m., or sorry, not 6 a.m. My dad wakes up at 4 a.m. every morning and goes out into the El Paso weather to work. And I never complain if I have to wake up at 6 or I have to stay at work until 2, because at least I'm not waking up at 4 a.m. and going out and doing the type of work. I asked a mentor of mine how it is that he became successful in his position. I won't say his name, but his response was very simple, right? How do you become successful? You just go out and do the work. So going back to how this kind of ties into being from the region, there's this great quote from Shakespeare, right? Some are born great, some achieve greatness, and some have greatness thrust upon them. Well, unfortunately, if you're from the area, it's, you know, you might not be born into some, you know, rich family with wealth that you can just go off and run for president with. So you might not be born great. Some of us do have some of that greatness thrust upon us, right, just in life. But I think most of us have to go out and achieve that greatness, right? But in order to go out and achieve that greatness, we have to have the right mindset. And that's sort of the drawback here of having maybe too much humility. So there's this kind of folk tale in Silicon Valley about Mark Zuckerberg's business cards. At some point, he had a business card, and that's true. He had a business card that said, I'm CEO of Edgecoin. And I think what's powerful about that, the statement that he makes, is that, you know, he had the personality of a CEO. Like, he knew he was CEO, and he embraced it. I don't think the guy knew that he was going to create one of the biggest companies in the world, but he definitely knew that he was the boss, and he had the personality that he was the boss, right? He was the CEO. And that's incredibly powerful, because growing up, my mentality was always this. I was always just a kid from El Paso, and anything that ever happened to me, I'm just a kid from El Paso. Not even El Paso. I was just a kid from Valentia. You could be a smart kid, but, you know, sorry, you just kind of don't have what you need around you. So you go from, you know, having these different types of perspectives, right? You don't know what's possible, so you go out and do it. You don't know it's possible, so maybe you don't try because you don't know that you can be. Or maybe you think it's impossible. You don't have that perspective that you can be CEO or that you can be boss. So you kind of preclude yourself from even going out and trying in the first place. And what I'm hoping to see, and what I think the city can engender more of, and I think the work that Emma is doing is already making big changes, is teaching kids that it is possible, right? And making sure that they know it's possible. Not just kids, I say kids, but I mean pretty much anyone, right? It's possible for anyone to go out and be a Steve Jobs or a Bill Gates and know that this is the model that we can emulate without necessarily being these like nerdy guys from Silicon Valley, right? Like, we can be who it is that we are and embrace the parts of us that make us tough and that make us good entrepreneurs. Yeah, I think the work that Emma and the MCA is doing is great. I think there's a lot of exciting stuff happening in the future. It makes me extra proud to be from here to see all this stuff happening. And I hope Tech Talks in the future kind of empower you guys to do more of all of this stuff. Hopefully, I don't know if you have any questions.
Good question. There's a lot of talk about Stanford.
Yes.
There's a lot of Stanford this and Stanford does. And there's a lot of universities in that area. What is so unique about Stanford that creates entrepreneurs?
So I'll give my take as having only been there the past 6 years. I can't answer it totally correctly because I don't have a full history of the school in my head, but what I've seen in the past few years is a very, I think there are a couple of things. There's sort of the economy that exists around the school, right? So if you go to Stanford, you see a bunch of startups starting around you, and you see a bunch of, you know, you drive from one airport to Stanford, and you drive by PayPal, you drive by eBay, you drive by Nortel, you drive by Cisco. If you're coming north and going south, you drive by Salesforce, you drive by Oracle, right? So it's around you. And if you're a student there, it's very obvious that entrepreneurship is a route that you can take because it's kind of just around you, right? You have this model for what it is that you can be. So I think that's part of it. The school itself, it's a private university, so it has a bit of flexibility in what it does. But when I worked at StartX, we were Stanford affiliated, and we did a bit of research around what it is that makes Stanford special. And I mean, I think there's a lot that other universities can do. They had a very streamlined process for taking intellectual property that was developed in the school and allowing the inventors, a lot of times, who were the students conducting the research at the school, to spin that technology out to a company. The school is kind of notorious for allowing, I mean, the school allows, I'm not sure if other schools restrict it, but professors can invest in their startups, their student startups. And because it has Silicon Valley around it, the current president has made a very big effort to kind of not necessarily incorporate Silicon Valley into Stanford, but I guess both to incorporate Stanford into Silicon Valley. So the organization that I worked for, I was a student volunteer for a very long time, originally started out as a student group, and then we became a nonprofit, like a separate entity separate from the university. And we were taking so many of these companies that were coming out of Stanford and helping them develop that it was appealing to the school, and we were able to create a partnership between the school and the program to make the program school affiliated, and we started getting some funding from the school because we were essentially taking their the technology that was being developed in the school and teaching the developers of it how to turn that into some sort of marketable product. And then what they recently did is they created the Stanford StartX Fund, which now invests cash. They had to create a separate legal entity to allow them to invest cash into the startups coming out of Stanford. So they're very proactive about making sure that they stay connected to the entrepreneurs coming out of that, and they've done a lot of things around their programming to make sure that, not their program, but to their policies to make sure that starting and developing a company at Stanford is something that is good. So they have a stop out policy. Any student can apply to stop out for, I think it's a really long time, it's 18 months or 3 years. So if you want to start a company, you can just leave your degree, try to start a company, and then if it doesn't work, you just come back. And they're not going to penalize you for it. So the school is very active about it, and they have a bunch of different policies. And I think any other university in the world can look at that and try to emulate some of that, because it's a very, you don't just have to wait for the stars to align to get a Facebook out next door, and you can proactively make policy changes.
So then private school is a lot different than public school, university.
Yes, I mean, I don't know, public school. I don't know too much about university administration yet, but if you're UTEP has to deal with the Texas State and the Texas State Board of Regents,
right.
Stanford doesn't have, so they can move a lot faster, right? Which is important for startups. You have to be able to move fast, and you have to be able to make changes very quickly. State schools might not have the same thing.
Right.
So that's some of my theories around why that's the case.
Does crowdfunding alter the
investment for this? I think so. I think if you're going to become a very big company, you still need VC funding, right? If you think of VC funding is essentially trading earns that you would get later for growth now, right? So future earnings for current growth, which crowdfunding doesn't necessarily offer. What crowdfunding does offer is it fills the gap in development, in product development, from a product being non-existent to existent. And then, what you see happen a lot is, I have a bunch of friends who've done this. They'll get a product kickstarted, it's a concept, and they'll just get enough money for the initial run of manufacturing, and they'll take that to a VC as proof that they can scale into a very big company, right? But I don't think crowdfunding does is it opens up avenues for funding for entities or companies that wouldn't have been able to get funding otherwise. So it kind of supplements VC funding, it doesn't totally replace it. If crowdfunding is enough for you, you probably weren't going to be able to get VC funding anyway, or maybe it just delays the need for VC funding. So they're very supplementary to each other.
So I have a question. I just want to pick your brain. You mentioned, for example, one of the things that we lack is models, right, for the students. So I see this a lot. I do research in biology, and most of my biology students that come into the lab, they want to go to med school. Because that's what they know. They don't think outside of that. So in an area that doesn't have a lot of biotechnology, all that stuff, what would be your thoughts of how can we, have models for the students?
So, and I have some thoughts on this, but kind of we were talking about this just a little bit earlier. One thing that I didn't notice this until I left, right? But if you're in the Bay Area, everybody knows all of the sort of Bay Area content, and a lot of them are internationally known. But there's these models kind of all around you. And what I find interesting about here is there are biotech industries here. There are biotech firms, right? We talked about some of the biotech manufacturing that's going on like at the maquilas, right? And I think the problem is it's there is stuff happening here and there's stuff going on, but it's hard to tie it to a face. And like if I had to think of the face of an industry leader, you know, and I'm not saying this as like a negative, I just grew up here and that's kind of what it is. I couldn't think of a face. I know what Bill Gates looks like. I know what Steve Jobs looks like. I know what some of the like not so big entrepreneurs in Silicon Valley who are still successful, I know what their faces look like. And in the area, they're kind of like little mini celebs, right? They're kind of like mini little celebrities and they get covered in like local publications. And here, like, I don't know of industry leader's name unless his name is on a building or like his company is named after him or her, right? So I think there's a lot that could be done to just kind of promote these people as positive examples for the community and promote them as people, not necessarily as businesses, because you know, no kid was ever inspired by like a business model or by like revenue numbers, right? People are inspired by people. So I think that might be a positive and pretty accessible change for the community. I'm not totally sure, but I saw that problem growing up myself. Like I said, to me, Steve Jobs and Bill Gates, like I saw them on like, you know, TV, and there was like little like documentary type movies made about them, and they weren't human to me because they lived in some other magical realm, right? Mm-hmm. So the people I looked up to and I actually tried to emulate were the people around me, and I just didn't have a whole lot of models for that. So if any of you guys are friends with industry leaders in the area, maybe you can convince them to, I don't know, make an Instagram or like, just, you know, get their, I think it has a lot more to do with the face than it does with the name.
We can start a program.
Yeah, that'd be great.
Any other questions? Thank you guys so much for taking the time to listen to me. I really appreciate it.
Stay, have a beverage, have some food, and if you haven't taken a tour of the building, we're happy to give you a tour of what we have going on here. So thank you all for being here.
By the way, if any of you want to get in touch with me for any reason, I think Emma has my contact information. My email address is really weird and memorable, but it's eric@hipsterpenguins.com. So it's E-R-I-K is the way that I spell my name, @hipsterpenguins.com. Feel free to email me there. Thank you.